Code blue, room 666. Code blue, room 666.
His pupils are dilated and unresponsive. What are we going to do, Dr. Whelden?
Dr. Whelden, his lungs are filling up. Nothing but rails. I need you to tell me what to do, quickly.
I can't feel a pulse. Tell me what to do, Dr. Whelden.
Dr. Whelden, he's starting to go down the tubes.
Dr. Whelden.
He's seizing.
Dr. Whelden.
We're losing him.
Dr.
What are we going to do?
Now I've got to make a decision. I'm at the corner of Center and Washington Street. The sun goes down in about 90 minutes. If I keep walking along the trail, I won't get to a camping spot until after dark. However, if I keep walking straight, I'll almost immediately be on this red dotted line, which is the Pat McGee Rail Trail.
I'm having another nightmare. This is the coat I wore in medical school. This is the tuning fork I used for physical exams on patients. Here's the notebook a pharmaceutical company gave me. These are the notes I jammed in my pocket. I find myself hiking the section I bypassed. Obviously, I feel guilty about not finishing what I set out to do. But why do I still feel guilty about not finishing medical school 40 years ago? I dropped out because, well, I'm not sure why. Is it because I'm lazy? Unable to handle pressure? Afraid of responsibility? Or is it something else?
Good dog, good dog. Come on, let's go. Come on. Let's go. Hello. I thought that two dogs walking on the road were kind of unusual, but...
Yeah, you're familiar. I know you.
Oh, I doubt that. I'm from Bradford County in Pennsylvania, but I... you know,
well, okay.
60 years old, Lynn Whelden. I make backpacking videos and...
Really?
Yeah.
We are the Whelden family. These are the only photographs showing the five of us together. My dad, college trained as a geologist. My mom, college trained as a musician and a teacher. My sister, bright, talented, and athletic. My brother, the brainy thinker, and me. We're sitting on a tree that Hurricane Carol toppled over a few days earlier, September 1st, 1954. The same thing is about to happen to us. In the blink of an eye, Roxanne's brain is destroyed, first by meningitis, then encephalitis. She cannot walk without assistance. She cannot feed herself. She has to wear diapers. She can't even communicate. Dad cannot handle this. He leaves and never comes back. Then Roy declares he's not going to be a scientist like his dad anymore. Through it all, Mom is tough and optimistic, so she places her expectations in me. I'm going to be the doctor who finds the cure for kids with brain damage. Sounds like a good plan. However, there's a problem, a big problem. Learning is a constant struggle. What takes a normal person an hour to learn takes me 2 or 3 hours, and that's in a quiet room. I invest crazy amounts of time poring over the textbooks and doing extra homework. It pays off. I graduate number one in my high school class. At Cornell University, I spend thousands of hours in the library, weekdays, weeknights, weekends, grinding away, finding little pleasure in the pursuit of knowledge. The facts I memorize stay in my head long enough for the test. Then they just seem to evaporate. Only one class do I really enjoy, film production. My 15-minute documentary comes from my heart full of passion. It's an amazing learning experience, and I get an A-. When I apply to medical school, I'm no longer sure I want to be a doctor. Four schools reject me, but the fifth one... I'm living in the ghetto of North Philadelphia. Temple University Medical School is about to begin. A warehouse burns outside my dormitory window. No siren can be heard. I go to the emergency room to watch doctors treat an unconscious man who's homeless. He has maggots living inside a leg wound, and he smells like death. I start to faint. On the way down, I hit my head on a wall. In anatomy class, we slice up dead human bodies. That's me in the white t-shirt, faking curiosity. Bruce is holding a head that's been sawed in half. During one class, we watch pornography. We'll then be confident when we deal with naked patients, or so the thinking goes. Frank had a nervous breakdown, so he's repeating the year. He practices taking this vial of blood out of my arm. I struggle to do the same thing with Frank. Live dogs are used to do physiology experiments on their kidneys. Then they're killed. Of course, I'm studying 16 hours a day. One night, a man steps out of the shadows right here, points a gun in my face, and demands money. Instead of handing him my wallet, I turn and run. He doesn't pull the trigger. After 2 weeks of this constant stress, feeling like I'm trapped inside a cage, I find a phone booth and call home. The conversation goes like this.
Mom, I'm being very rational. Please listen to me. I don't belong here. I think I should leave medical school. If I get out now, someone on the waiting list can fill my position.
Don't be a fool. You cannot quit what you just started. Things will get better, and besides, I don't know anyone who likes what they do for a job. You don't have to like med school.
Mom's life is hard. Day after day, she sits on Roxanne's bed in the kitchen, calmly feeding her, giving enemas, changing diapers. Mom never complains about the daily seizures, the choking, the inability to communicate. It's a tragic situation, and I'm only making it worse. I can't do that.
Okay, Mom. I'll hang in there. For at least a year.
chance to dry out my feet and drink something other than water or flavored water.
It's 4 o'clock in the afternoon. I'm trying to sleep in my dorm room. Suddenly, I find myself in what looks like an auditorium. Some sort of graduation ceremony is going on. All my classmates are there, except me. I'm in the back of the room, outside, looking in. Do I stay or do I go? The battle goes on in my brain. Year one. Year two. Year three. I learn so little in class, I start skipping. I try to read textbooks in the library instead. I study notes taken by those who do go to class. But the big picture, a take-home message, is always out of reach. I make tiny notes and put them in my pocket because I never trust my memory. Through it all, Mom tries to give me guidance through her letters. Quit dreaming about filmmaking, dear, and grow up. I would hate to see you someday working in a factory. I'd be thinking, he threw it all away. You have to stick it out with an open mind for a year. Your problem of not being able to learn and remember, if you keep trying, you can find a way. Aren't you developing any bit of interest in research? I've never seen your personality as it is now. You seem so cross and edgy and impatient. Auntie moans about your new plans, and like everyone else, doubts you'll go back. She says, all that money down the drain. Those new plans she's talking about? I'm taking a year off to follow a dream I put on hold. My heart leads me to Bob Jones University, an ultra-conservative Christian school in Greenville, South Carolina. Like a man who's been starving, I consume every film course I possibly can. I struggle with the school's fundamentalism, They have a rules and regulations handbook. Their demerit system penalizes me for the length of my hair, attending a charismatic church, and going to Jesus 79, a Christian music festival. I'm this close to getting kicked out. In the midst of this strange yet wonderful environment, I write on a piece of paper, I simply do not enjoy the mental effort required to think medically, but I enjoy learning the art of filmmaking. I love every crazy minute of it. How long do I force a square peg into a round hole? I make a short film for camera class. A mysterious character takes drastic measures to find relief.
Do you have a camp store or
It's right here.
Junk food, something like that?
Yeah. You look for a campsite or just for
munchies? Just munchies.
Come on in. Right. there's some chips across the way, peanuts.
Thank you. Morning. I'm back in medical school now. My fourth and final year begins with a two-week cardiology rotation at St. Luke's Hospital. My attitude is horrible. I call my girlfriend Kay at her parents' house. We met as film students at Bob Jones University.
I cannot take it anymore,
I tell Kay's mom, whom I respect as a devout Christian. She says,
Lynn, I understand.
I know what I have to do. I track down Dr. Hugo Smith, the Dean of Curriculum. We've spoken many times over the years. I tell him I'm leaving for good. I drive to Mom's house that evening. It takes her many years to recover from the shock and disappointment. Auntie, my great aunt, who lamented about all that money going down the drain, takes my name out of her will. And so the nightmares begin.
They had those hand washers that you took the tank off and you flush it in the water that normally flush it with toilet, you feel the rest of it. Yeah.
Good dog. Yippee.
Morning. Guys, just out for the day or?
Yeah, just live right down here.
Oh, very cool. Like, very
just,
cool.
Just mowed it yesterday.
Oh, so. I appreciate that.
I'd like a chocolate ice cream cone.
Hi there.
How you doing?
Good.
Careful, there's some bear cubs up there.
Oh my goodness.
So.
The safe thing to do would be to stay at the shelter, even though it was early afternoon. Rest up for the big push tomorrow. The crazy thing to do would be to start right now and to try to get all the way to the end, which would mean after dark. Or the chancy thing to do would be to just set out and see how far I can go and see what options for camping present themselves. A 13-mile road walk, starting now.
3 miles to the main road.
It's 4:45. My feet feel like they're about ready to fall off. We've got about 2.5 hours of daylight left. It's 7 miles to my car in the parking lot. It's 8 miles to the end of the trail. I'm gonna try to at least make it to the car. It's 6:45. I'm still 2 miles from the car, so I'm gonna stop at this little bivouac place along the road. I'm tired.
I am not a quitter, and yet I quit medical school. Why? To get some answers I go to the Amen Clinic in Virginia to have my brain scanned. A radioactive dye injected into my bloodstream lights up particular circuits in my head, circuits involved with thinking. The machine produces a three-dimensional picture that reveals the so-called diamond pattern, sometimes associated with post-traumatic stress disorder. Could the stressful blood and guts, life and death environment of medical school cause PTSD? Is that why I still have nightmares?
Tell me what to do, Dr. Whelden.
Looking for another piece of the puzzle, I have my eyes tested by a behavioral optometrist. She discovers what she calls stress-inducing vision disorders, but her recommendations fall on deaf ears, and I don't follow up. I find a neuropsychologist willing to screen me for learning disabilities. A test like this focuses on my ability to remember. Three different tests demonstrate either mild or moderate memory impairment. A fourth test, called PASAT, I can't even finish, it's so difficult. His score is surprisingly weak, the report reads, given the academic success that he had. The doctor concludes that anxiety causes my learning problems, but I believe it's just the opposite. Learning problems cause anxiety. So I keep moving on. I read a book on auditory processing disorder. It seems to describe my situation, so off I go to Bloomsburg University's hearing clinic to have my ears tested. APD makes it difficult to follow conversation. It's also hard to remember complex verbal information. Not much gets past my eardrums when you're talking lectures, sermons, and long-winded conversations. But their exam uncovers nothing. Another dead end. Finally, my quest leads me to St. Clair Avenue in Toronto, Canada. This is Arrowsmith School, founded by Barbara Arrowsmith in 1980. She wrote the book, The Woman Who Changed Her Brain, about how she overcame her own crippling learning disabilities. Barbara's research has identified at least 19 different disabilities. That's why I'm here, to undergo a day and a half of testing. One exercise requires me to listen to four simple sentences. I'm supposed to repeat them back. It seems simple enough, but I find it very difficult, almost impossible to do. When they tell me their final assessment, I don't know if I should laugh or cry. Six disabilities, three considered moderate to severe, three mild to moderate. If I'd only known this 40 years ago. It reminds me of the joke about the guy who's pounding his head against a brick wall. Someone asks, "Why are you doing that?" He says, "It feels so good when I stop." I didn't quit medical school. I stopped banging my head against the wall.